Welcome my students, this is the sixth lecture on the chapter of interference. So in the previous lecture we had seen about how using a thin film we can obtain coherent sources from a single ray of light. Now in this part we are going to start with a derivation, the first derivation in this chapter. So this is about interference in a parallel thin film for reflected light. While discussing about obtaining coherent sources using thin films, we had seen that when the incident ray falls on the thin film, the light gets split up into reflected rays on the upper side of the film and transmitted rays on the lower side of the film. So in this derivation here, we'll be dealing with reflected rays, the rays R1, R2, R3 and so on. Also remember, in the reflected rays, there were rays R1, R2, R3, R4 and so on. But you had mentioned earlier that the rays R3 onwards will not be considered for any practical purposes because the amplitude of these rays R3 onwards is very, very small. So only rays R1 and R2 will be considered for the derivation. So we have over here in this derivation interference in a parallel thin film due to reflected light. Now why is this called a parallel thin film? Because the upper surface of the film, that is PQ, the upper surface of the surface of the film PQ and the lower surface of the film P dash Q dash, they both the surfaces are parallel to each other. Or we can say that the thickness P of the film is constant throughout the film. Such a film is said to be a parallel film. Now, we are having a film whose having a refractive index mu. Now, this film could be of any material. It could be glass, it could be plastic, it could be even be air. So, in general, we have taken the refractive index of the film as mu. In case the film is a film of air, then the mu value will be 1. If the film is glass, then the value of mu will be 1.5 and so on for different mediums, different materials of the film. Now, for this purpose of this derivation, to make the derivation a little bit simpler, we are going to assume that the film is made of, let us say, glass, and on both sides of the film is air. Okay, so the refractive index on the outside the film is 1, whereas inside the film the refractive index, let us say, is mu. So what is happening here? We have a ray of light, incident ray of light IA, falling on the upper surface of the film. So this is the incident ray IA. At A we know the light splits into a reflected ray R1 and a transmitted ray AB. Then at point B again the ray splits into two parts because it undergoes a change of medium. The ray splits into a reflected ray BC, and a transmitted ray T1. And then again at point C, the again light splits up into a reflected ray, which is this one here, and a transmitted ray, which is coming out of the film, that is CR2, the reflected ray R2. Now, the purpose of this derivation here is to find out what are called as the conditions for maximas and minimas. So, in other words, we are going to find out conditions under which these two rays, R1 and R2, the rays R1 and R2, reflected rays, since we are doing the derivation for reflected light, we are going to derive the condition under which the rays R1 and R2 will undergo constructive interference or destructive interference. So constructive interference will give rise to maxima, destructive interference will give rise to minima. So now you may see that in this figure here the rays R1 and R2 are parallel. So you may wonder how will they undergo interference, because for interference the rays have to meet each other. But as I told you earlier, we can, even if the rays are parallel, we can always make them to meet by placing a lens in their path. Okay? So if I make a convex lens in their path, the rays can be made to meet at a common point. And this is the point P, let us say, at which they are going to undergo the interference. Now, my aim is to find out whether at this point P, is it going to be a bright spot or a dark spot, maxima or a minima? Now, to know that, we have to know how much is the path difference between the rays R1 and R2. Because if we know the path difference, then based on the condition for maxima and minima, we can tell whether at that point P it's going to be a bright spot, maxima, or a dark spot, minima. You must be remembering, if the path difference between the rays delta is equal to n lambda, then it produces a maxima, it's a condition for constructive interference. Whereas if the path difference delta is 2n plus 1 times lambda by 2, then the rays will undergo destructive interference. This is the condition for minima, destructive interference. So now, if we know the value of delta, therefore, if we know the value of delta, we can then comment on whether the rays R1 and R2 will undergo constructive interference or destructive interference. So the main part of this derivation will be finding out the path difference between the rays, path difference delta, capital delta, between the rays R1 and R2. So this is the major part of the derivation. Then obtaining the conditions for maxima and minima is very simple. All that we will do is we will substitute this condition and this condition to obtain the condition for maxima and minima. So the first thing what we are going to do is find the value of the path difference delta between the two rays. So let's see how we do that. Now, in this figure here, let me explain you the different angles there. Now, this IA, that ray IA, is incident on the film at an angle of incidence I. This dotted line which you see here is the normal. I label it as N dash. So this is basically the normal to the film, surface of the film. So angle of incidence is the angle made by the incident ray IA with the normal, so it's angle I. This angle here made by the ray R1 is also I. Why? Because R1 is a reflected ray. It's a ray reflected from the film. So as per the laws of reflection, angle of incidence and angle of reflection must be same. So therefore, if this angle this side is I, this side angle also is I. Then this ray AB is a refracted ray. So the angle made by the refracted ray with the normal is called as the angle of refraction, and it is denoted by the symbol small r. Okay. Then the ray hits the lower surface of the film at point B, and at the angle at which it hits the ray, angle of incidence at which the ray AB hits the lower surface of the film is R. Why? Because since this dotted line NNS and this dotted line HB are parallel to each other, these two angles here are alternate interior angles. So therefore, if this angle here is R, this angle here also is R. Okay, so that's how this angle here becomes R. Now again, this angle here also is R. Why? Because the ray BC is a reflected ray. It's a ray reflected from the lower surface of the film. So therefore, if the angle at which the ray was incident was R, this side angle also must be equal to R. So that's how this angle comes. Now, this dotted line which you see here is a normal from point B onto the upper surface of the film. So therefore, the angles both sides here are 90 degrees. Next, what is done over here is at from point C, we have dropped the normal onto the ray R1. So this angle here is 90. So this dotted line which you see here is a normal dropped onto the ray R1. Now, this angle here, angle GCA, angle GCA is also equal to I. Now, why is that I? We can prove that it is I because we know here this angle NA. R1, angle NAR1 is equal to I. Therefore, since angle NAQ is 90 degrees, the angle R1AH will be equal to 90 minus I. Right? So the angle here, this angle here, will be 90 degrees minus I. Now next thing, in this triangle here, in triangle AGC, the angle AGC is 90. So now we know that in our triangle, the sum of all the angles in a triangle is 180. So if angle AGC of the triangle is 90, it implies that angle GAC plus angle GCA will be equal to 90, because the total sum of the angles in a triangle must be 180. So now, we know that angle GAC is 90 minus I. This angle here is 90 minus I. Yeah, so this angle here is 90 minus I. So if I put it as 90 minus I there, plus angle GAC, sorry, angle GCA it is, angle GCA is equal to 90. So if you solve this thing and if you find out the angle, you will get an angle GCA is equal to I. Okay, the 90-90 will cancel out on both sides and you will get angle GCA as equal to I. So that's how we have got this angle here as equal to I. Okay, so this is just to prove that angle GCA is equal to I. In the derivation, we will be using that value. Okay. Okay, so let's proceed further and we'll start with the main part of the derivation. So, as I told you, my aim is to find out if these two rays R1 and R2 will interfere constructively or destructively. For that, what I need to do is, I need to find a path difference between them. So, at this point P here, I want to find out whether it's going to be constructive or destructive, maximum or minimum. So, I'm going to find out the path difference between the ray R1 and R2. Now, if you see in this figure here, path difference is always a positive value. You have to find the path of the bigger ray minus the path of the smaller ray to find the path difference. The path difference is basically the path of ray R2. The path difference delta can be written as the path of ray R2. Because R2 is a bigger ray. Why do I say it's a bigger ray? You see in the figure, if this is the starting point, I is the starting point of both the rays. That's the common starting point of both the rays. From I, the ray goes to point A. From point A, directly the ray R1 arises. The ray R1 directly arises from reflection at point A. Whereas to get the ray R2, what has happened? From point I, the light has to go to A. From A, it has to go down to B. From B, it has to go up to C. And then it gives rise to the ray R2. So the ray, the total path of the ray R2 is bigger than the path of the ray R1. So to find the path difference, you have to subtract the path of the bigger ray minus the path of the smaller ray. So path of R2 minus path of R1. Okay. So now let's trace the path of R2 and let's trace the path of R1. So you can see the figure there. It will be equal to IA plus AG. You can look at the figure, tracing the path of the ray R1 starts from point I. So AG plus, let us say, GP. Okay, so that's the path of the ray R1. IA plus AG plus GP. So minus the path of R2, ray R2. So the ray R2 also starts from the point I, so it goes from I to A plus AB plus BC plus CP. Okay, so that is the path of the ray R2 and the path of the ray R1. I think I interchanged the thing there. Actually, this should have gone on top. This part here is the path of R2 and this path here is the part of R1. So I'll just rewrite it over there. Okay, so let's rewrite that thing equation again. So it is path of R2 minus path of R1. So this will become equal to IA plus AB plus BC plus CP. So this is the path of the ray R2 minus the path of the ray R1 will be IA plus AG plus GP. Okay, so this is the path difference delta between the rays R2 and R1. Now, if you see in this thing, what is common over there is IA, IA, both places it is common, it will cancel out. Also, if you see the distance GP, this distance GP and the distance CP, they are both equal from the geometry of the figure. You can say the distance from G to P and the distance from C to P, they are both equal. Okay, so they also will both cancel out. So what we'll get this equation as equal to AB plus BC minus AG. So this is the path difference between the rays R2 and R1. But now we need to take care of one more thing. If you remember, in the one of the sections we had discussed that whenever a ray of light gets reflected from the surface of a denser medium, the reflected ray has an extra phase of pi. It suffers a phase change of pi, or it has an extra path of lambda by 2. Now among these two rays, the ray R1 and R2, which of them arises from reflection from a denser medium? If you see the ray R1 arises from reflection at point A, whereas R2 arises from reflection at point B. Now reflection at point A occurs at a denser medium because the ray is incident from air to, let us say, glass. So at point A, the reflection occurs at a denser medium. Whereas the ray R2 arises because of reflection from point B. At point B, the reflection occurs from the surface of a rarer medium because the ray from glass, it is falling onto air. So the reflection at point B occurs at a rarer medium. So therefore, what will happen is the ray R1, which arises from reflection at a denser medium, will have an extra path of lambda by 2 in it, which will not be in the ray R2, because R2 arises from reflection at rarer medium. So therefore, in this expression for paths which we have written, the path of ray R1, which arises from reflection at a denser medium, will have an additional path of lambda by 2, which I cannot show as a physical distance in the figure. I cannot show it as a physical value, how much in the figure I cannot be drawn and shown. But we know it is there. Why? Because R1 arises because of reflection from a surface of a denser medium. So this is the final expression for the path difference between the rays R2 and R1. So let us call this as equation number 1. Okay. Now all I have to do here is find the value of AB, find the value of BC, and find the value of AG from this figure here, and put them in this expression and obtain a path expression for path difference delta. So let's see how to do that. Okay. So please keep this in mind. This is equation 1. It's an important part of this derivation, important equation. All those values which you are going to find out, AB, BC, and AG, we are going to substitute them back into the equation 1. So let's proceed now into finding the value of AB, BC, and AG. So now, in the triangle AHB, it's a right angle triangle. In triangle AHB, how much is cos of R? Cos R, this angle here is R here. So cos of R will be AH upon BC. Cos of R is opposite side upon, sorry, cos of R is adjacent side upon hypotenuse. So it will be HB upon AB. Adjacent side is HB and hypotenuse of the triangle is AB. So now, in the figure if you see, HB is nothing but the thickness of the film T. You can refer in the figure, HB is nothing equal to T, so it becomes T upon AB. So from this figure, from this thing, we can imply therefore that AB is equal to T upon cos R. Okay, so let's say this is equation number 2. Now, also if you see these two triangles, triangle AHB and triangle CHB, they are both congruent. They are both congruent to each other. Why are they congruent? Because you can see they have two angles which are 90 degrees. They have two angles which are equal to R, and they have a common side. HB is a common side. So by angle side angle rule, you can say that these two triangles are congruent. This is triangle AHB is congruent to triangle CHB. So therefore, we can imply from this congruency rule that the distance AB is equal to the distance BC. Okay? So which further we can imply that AB plus BC, I can therefore write it as equal to just 2 times AB, because both AB and BC are equal to each other. So this is equation number 3. What we are going to do now is, we have already found the value of AB from equation number 2. So we are going to put the value of AB in equation number 3, and that will give me the value of AB plus BC. So substituting, if you substitute equation number 2 in 3, substitute equation number 2 in equation number 3, we are going to get this. We are going to get it as AB plus BC is equal to 2t upon cos r. So what you have done is, we have substituted equation number 2 in equation number 3, and that's how you got the value of AB plus BC. So this is equation number 4. So if you see, we have already obtained the first part of this equation 1. Equation 1 was AB plus BC. So we have already obtained the value of AB plus BC. It is 2t upon cos r as given by equation number 4. Now all that remains is to find the value of AG. Okay, so once you get value of AG, we will put back everything in equation 1 and we will solve it further. So let's proceed further now in finding the value of AG. Now in this triangle here, triangle AGC, which is a right angle triangle, how much is sin I? This angle here is I. So how much is sin of I there? Sin I is opposite side upon hypotenuse, so it will be AG upon AC, right? So opposite side upon hypotenuse. So therefore, from this we can write that AG, we are interested in finding the value of AG for our derivation. So AG will be AC sin I. Okay, so this is equation number 5. Next, what we will do is, in the congruency rule, this we already know that this triangle AHB and triangle CHB are both congruent to each other. So therefore, we can write that AH is equal to HC. Okay, this distance AH and the distance HC are equal, because the two triangles, we already said earlier that they are congruent. So if they are both congruent, therefore we can write further from this statement that AC will be equal to 2 times AH, because AH and HC are equal to each other. Okay, so this is equation number 6. Now all that we need to do is find the value of AH. You see, the triangle AHB, in triangle AHB, what is tan of R? Tan R, here this angle here is R. So tan of R will be opposite side upon adjacent side. So it will be AH upon HB. So this will be equal to AB, and we already know that HB is nothing but the thickness of the film T. So from this we can imply therefore that AB, sorry, I think I have done a mistake here, opposite side is AH, not AB. So this here is AH, yes, so this here is AH upon HB, and this also is AH upon T. So now, so therefore, if tan R is AH upon T, we will therefore get that AH is equal to T tan R. Okay, this is equation number 7. So now we are almost done with that. So we have, from equation 7, you can see AH is T tan R. We are going to put the value of this equation 7 of AH into equation number 6. And then follow, whatever value of AC we are going to get, we are going to put a value in equation number 5. So we are going to do now back substitution, 7 in 6 and then 6 in 5. Okay, and then we will see what we get as the final equation. So 7 will be substituted in equation number 6. So So equation number 6, you can see here AC is equal to 2AH. So substitute equation 7 in 6 will give me AC equal to 2 times AC is equal to 2 times AH. And how much is AH? AH is T10R. So this will become 2 times 10R. Okay, so this is equation number, let us say 8. So we are going to substitute for the 8 into equation number 8, we are going to substitute into equation number 5. And that will give me, so we are going to put the value of AC as 210R. Okay, AC is equal to 210R in this equation. So over here, we are going to substitute AC as 210R. So we will get AG as 210R sin I. AG will be 210R sin I. T10R sin I. Okay, so this is equation number 9. So now, if you see, now we have obtained a value for in the derivation for equation 1, we wanted the value of AB, BC, and AG. You can see here, equation number 4, we have obtained the value of AB plus BC, and further in equation number 9, now we have obtained the value of AG. So all you need to do now is substitute the value of AG and AB plus BC into equation number 1. But before doing that, we will slightly simplify this expression a little bit more further, because if you see how many variables are there in this equation, there is T, there is R, and there is I. Three variables are there for the value of AG, whereas for the value of AB plus BC, there are only two variables, T and R. I is missing over there, I is not there. So it is always better to have lesser number of variables. So what we are going to do is, we are going to, from equation number 9, this extra I, we are going to eliminate it and substitute in terms of might be R or T. So let's see how to do that. So I want to eliminate this extra variable I from equation number 9. So we can use, for that we are going to use Snell's law. What does Snell's law say? Sin I upon sin R is equal to mu, the refractive index. So from this we can get, therefore, that sin I is equal to mu sin R. So sin I is equal to mu sin R. This is equation number 10. So we are going to put the value of this equation number 10 in equation number 9, and that will give you the final value of AG. So sin I is mu sin R. So what will the final expression for equation number 9, that is AG, will become? So we substitute equation number 10 in 9. So equation number 10 substituted in 9 will give me AG is equal to, how much was that? AG is 2T10R sin I. So 2T10R into sin I. Sin I is mu sin R. So mu sin R. So this will finally become equal to, I can get as 2 mu T. Now 10R can be written as sin R upon cos R. So sin R, and already there is another sin R there, so it will become 2 mu T sin square R upon. Okay, so this is final equation for me, equation number 11. Okay, for value for AG. So now equation number 11, that is AG, and equation number 4 over here for AB plus BC, we are going to substitute in equation number 1 for delta. Okay, delta. So let's see what we do after this all the substitution. So we are going to get it as, so we are going to substitute equation number 11, equation number 4 in equation number 1. So with this substitution, we are going to get delta as equal to AB plus BC, which is here 2t upon cos r. So 2t upon cos r plus rather minus 2 mu t sin square r upon cos r. Okay, now if you see here in equation number 1, the slight thing which you have missed out, there should be a mu which is multiplied over here. Okay, so this actually there is a mu multiplied there. I'll tell you why that mu is there. If you see the ray AB and BC in this figure, in this thin film derivation, AB and BC are inside the film which has a refractive index mu. So therefore, if you remember the initial lecture, optical path, when we consider it, is the actual physical distance multiplied with the refractive index mu. Okay, so when we want to calculate the optical path, because this is a ray of light which we are dealing with, so we have to deal with not just physical distance but the actual optical distance. Optical distance is the actual physical distance multiplied with the refractive index in which the medium in which the light is moving. So the ray AB and BC is inside the film which has a refractive index mu. So therefore, the optical path AB BC will be the actual physical distance AB plus BC multiplied with mu. Now there's no mu coming over here for AG. Why? Because the ray AG is outside the film, it is in air. So the refractive index of air is 1. So here the value of mu doesn't come. So only in this here AB plus BC has to be multiplied with mu because they are inside the film. Okay, so please consider that mu there. So the final expression for equation 1 will become 2 mu t here. That is the mu coming which we have missed out earlier. So over here there will be a mu coming. So 2 mu t upon cos r. Now what you see in both these things which is common is 2 mu t upon cos r is common. So I can write it as equal to 2 mu t upon cos r common, and inside the bracket one more thing over here is that is plus lambda by 2 over here. Remember that lambda by 2 factor which is also there over there. Okay, so 2 mu t from these two terms, 2 mu t is common, so I can write it as 1 minus sin square r, and then outside the bracket that will become minus because of the minus sign there, will become minus lambda by 2. Now 1 minus sin square r is cos square r, so there is already a cos r down in the denominator here, so cos square r and cos r, one of the cos r will get cancelled out, and the final equation for delta will then be delta is equal to 2 mu t cos r, one of the cos r will remain, 2 mu t cos r plus or rather minus lambda by 2. So this is my final equation, the expression for the path difference between the two rays r1 and r2. This is equation number 12. Now after getting this equation, all that you need to do further is put the conditions for constructive interference and destructive interference. We know that if delta is n lambda, we get constructive maxima, and if delta is 2n plus 1 lambda by 2, we get destructive interference or minima. So now all that we will do further is write the conditions for maximas and minimas. So condition first we'll do for maxima. So for maxima we know that delta is equal to n lambda. Okay, so maxima is obtained when the rays interfere constructively, and constructive interference takes place when delta is n lambda. So we put the value of this delta in equation number 12, what we will get there? So substitute in 12, what we are going to get is n lambda is equal to 2 mu t cos r minus lambda by 2. Now what you are going to do is you are going to simplify this, take the lambda terms common, and simplified. And if on simplification, you will get this thing as 2 mu t cos r. So 2 mu t cos r I have taken on one side, and the other two terms I have combined, the lambda terms I have combined. So you should get it as 2 n plus 1 times lambda by 2. You can work this out and see. You will get this answer. Okay? On simplification, on taking the lambda terms common, you will get this answer. So this is the condition for maxima. Condition for maxima. Okay? In a parallel thin film due to reflected light. Now similarly, the condition for minima can be obtained by putting the value of delta in equation 12 as 2n plus 1 lambda by 2, because the condition for destructive interference is delta is equal to 2n plus 1 lambda by 2. So for minimum, to obtain the minimum condition, all that we do is to put a value of delta as 2n plus 1 times lambda by 2 in equation 12. So substitute this value in equation 12, the main value for delta, and we will get 2n plus 1 times lambda by 2 is equal to 2 mu t cos r minus lambda by 2. Again over here, the lambda terms you can take common, 2 mu t cos r you can keep on one side. So on simplification of this thing, you will get it as 2 mu t cos r is equal to n plus 1 lambda. You can work it out and see. This is the value we will get on simplification of this equation. Now, here, n plus 1, whatever the number system it is, n plus 1, you remember n is an integral number. It can take values like 0, 1, 2, 3 and so on. So, n plus 1 also is an integral number system. It doesn't, if n doesn't have a decimal, n plus 1 will also not have a decimal place. It will not be a fraction. It's also an integral whole number. So, we can always replace n plus 1 and just instead of n plus 1, you can just write it as n itself, because that does not change the number system. N is also an integral number, n plus 1 also is an integral number. Both cannot have fractions. So, to make this expression simpler, what I'm going to do is I'm just going to write it as 2 mu t cos r is equal to just n lambda. The 1 I can drop it from there, because whether the 1 is there or not, the number system remains the same. It is still an integral number system. So, this is the condition for minimum. Okay? Condition for minimum in a parallel thin film due to reflected light. So, we have obtained condition for maxima. This is the condition for maxima. And this is the condition for minima in a parallel thin film due to reflected light. So, with this, the derivation ends here. We have to do a similar derivation for transmitted light also. Okay? So, that part I will be explaining in the next class. Thank you.